I brought my big yellow button. Hiya. Hello. Thanks very much. Right, okay, so I've got a lot to say, not much time to say it in. My name is Gavin Strange. I go by the name of JamFactory on the internet. I live and work here in beautiful BS1, Bristol. Is this BS1? No? I work in BS1 anyway, just over the road. Same thing, isn't it, BS? And, you know, I love this city. It's famous for its big, beautiful bridges. It's famous for interesting, great music and just amazing artists and getting things done and making things happen. It's a wonderful place to live. I live here and love living in the city with my wonderful wife, Jane, our beautiful adopted rescue greyhound, Peggy, and my muse, my love, my everything, our beautiful son, Sullivan Gray Strange, who I'm pretty sure is as intended that children are just the ultimate inspiration to do everything from the day he was born. I've just wanted to make stuff for him because of him. And he has basically made me create the best things I've ever made in my whole entire life. I can ever make anything better than that, which is just a shameless rip-off of something that already exists. I don't actually know why I still go to work every day. It's never going to get better than that. So, who I am is I'm a director and a designer for a wonderful place called Aardman Animations. So that is what I do and what I love to do. So I'm a director and designer for Aardman Animations. And if you've not heard of Aardman, it's a creative studio that is 40 years old now, 40 years plus. And it was created by Dave Sproxton and Peter Lord. And they met at school, they became childhood friends, and they just started playing and experimenting and turned it into a company. They don't have any formal training, they didn't go to film school, they went to university, sure, but they didn't study anything to do with film. They developed their passions and their hobbies and turned it into a multi-million pound business that's still here 40 years later. And what I love, I adore, there's so many reasons why I love working there. I mean, the first is I grew up watching what they made, you know. I like most of us, you know, at Christmas time you would sit around BBC One and you would watch the shorts on Christmas Day. So I've always been aware of this place that has a legacy for just making stuff that is wonderful and is charming and is sweet and is funny and has no ulterior motive other than to delight you. And so, you know, I grew up just adoring this place, and when I moved to Bristol, I demanded my friend take me to where the building was. I just had to see this space. And it was chucking it down in Bristol. Of course it is. Got absolutely soaked. And then we trudged her all the way there and he went, there you go. It's just a normal grey building. And I remember going, oh, but still it's odd. When, you know, that place radiated energy. And so I joined there as a senior interactive designer. I won't go through my whole path, but I started life as a junior graphic designer. I didn't go to university. I wanted to go straight into the industry and became a junior graphic designer, but then very early on I got the opportunity to be a web designer, or a new media designer, as it was called in the early 2000s. I was like, that sounds exciting, I don't know what that word means. Yeah, sure, let's go for it. I was 18 years old, I wouldn't have done anything that anyone told me. Okay, sure, thanks, cool. And I just pursued it, but in my own time, I was really interested in all the different disciplines, because this is the thing, right, you know, we are all known for what our business card says or what it says on our email signature, or, you know, we have to fit into some sort of box for someone, on someone's spreadsheet, on someone's database, because that's how the world works. You need to be hired or you need to get a role based on what people tell, you know, you tell people that you do. But of course, we're all so much more interested in such a huge wide variety, more stuff than what we say. So basically from early on, I never shied away from just sharing all the other stuff I was excited on, that I was developing, that I was just trying. And to be honest, anything that I would manage to conjure up, I was just stoked it existed. I just had a very low bar for myself, incredibly low, just sort of like that. That's as high as the bar was, purely because I grew up in Leicester in the Midlands, where it was not a particularly thrilling, exciting metropolis growing up, and I just didn't really expect much of myself. I never had too much to shout about growing up. I wasn't good at anything. This is not a sob story. This is, I was never truly bad, but I was never truly good. I just was. And I presume that is what life is and would continue to be. But then as I started just experimenting and hacking and tinkering in my own time with just all the stuff that excited me, because no one had ever told me that I couldn't. And we're living in this incredible age where you really can just learn something in 10 minutes and just start playing and figuring it out and breaking it and making it. I was so thrilled that little me, could just make something from nothing. I was just stoked and I would just share it with everyone and anyone, predominantly my mum and dad and brother, and they'd be like, yeah, great. What are you doing? And just anyone that would listen. And in this age, this was 99-2000, you know, we would all, you know, you'd find places to hang out, whether that's IIRC or PHP BB, you know, boards for different things you're interested in, and just share this stuff. And more I did, the more confidence it gave me to just go further, try more, try new things. And so basically I would just have my day job that I was being paid for as a junior web designer, digital designer. But then I was just doing all this stuff on the side, and I basically continue to do that and still continue to do that to this day. I'm 37 now, so nearly 20 years later, I'm still doing the same thing. I have a day job, which I very much love and enjoy, but it's not the sum total of who I am. I'm interested in so much more than all of that. So I go home and try and do things where I can. And I didn't shy away from sharing this with the people that at Aardman, my bosses, my peers, people of all levels, because that place started by two, you know, school kid friends creating something, they really respected that and they really latched onto that because that's how they got somewhere. And it gave me the confidence to say, well, maybe I'll just share then. Maybe I'll just show. Very long story short, I joined as a graphic designer, as a visual designer, but I didn't shy away from making my filmmaking excitement not known, basically. I would do lots of projects in Bristol, collaborate with lots of friends, do lots of side projects, basically, to make moving image. You know, really, moving image and designing, they are the same thing. It's just taking lots of pictures and making pictures move. Same thing, isn't it? So I just would sort of share that more and more. And then, basically, a couple of years ago, with lots of support and training at this place, I sort of jumped the rails, really. I went from being a designer to a director. You know, so I look after and direct projects making moving image in all sorts of disciplines. I still do lots of interactive work. I still do lots of UI, UX, basically anything visual. Again, I've just not shied away from saying, I'll do anything. Well, logo? Yeah, I'll do it. Film? Yeah, I'll do that too. You know, because why not? We're all here. We have these skills. We have these interests. You know, life's too short not to. Why would you not want to just try and learn something new? Even if it's something you've done a million times, if you do it a million and one times, it'll be that tiny bit better, you know? So I've just always just saw the benefit in iteration. And surely, you know, I'm just speaking to the converted. Of course, you do something, then you iterate. You do something and you iterate. You know, so many people get so scared to just start that thing or to even complete that thing because it's not perfect. The time's not right. I don't have the money. I don't have this. It's not as good as so-and-so. just, you know, you've got to, you've really got to just put it out there and then do better the next time, you know. By sort of sharing it and making it public, you're sort of, that's really scary and hard, and you go, and then you realise that the world doesn't implode, it just exists, and generally people don't care about it, but, you know, it means something to you, but it, you know, it's that sense of completion, of putting it out there, of having the confidence to do it, and then building upon it and making something new. But that's the point. I just, you know, you don't stop being creative at 5:30 or 6 when you finish school or uni or your job or childcare, whatever it is. You know, your brains are always thinking, working, tinkering along, and it's sort of tuning into that and just knowing that we're all creative in all sorts of aspects, in all different ways, all of the time, and just trying to channel that. So this is really what my talk is about, really, about doing everything and nothing, doing it well, doing it badly, but doing it. That's the point. It's about doing it. And I'm going to talk about the specifics. It's all well and good going, hey guys, just do what you love. What does that statement even mean? Like, there's so many, we could all go onto Instagram right now and go, just live your dreams. What does that mean? It means nothing. You know, so it's there's got to be a realistic way to make this stuff happen. Because the sentiment is lovely, don't get me wrong. You know, we are living in a nightmarish hellscape today. Oh my God. You know, we need to be positive. Of course we need positive sentiments, but sometimes if that positivity isn't applied, it can turn sour really quickly because you just feel like you're sort of lying to yourself. So it's all about finding possible ways to make stuff happen. And I just want to try my hand at everything. I love making 3D stuff. I love making 2D stuff. I love making really small things. I love making really big things. I love capturing still images of things. And I even like expanding it into now, and this is a new thing for me, making more music. I'm getting progressively worse at playing drums, but it doesn't stop me smacking the poo out of them. But then just trying to find new ways and avenues to explore that. So I've just got into making more music production in different ways. But then, you know, like when you're excited and all these different things, it's connecting the dots. It's doing what excites you and trying to craft them in unique ways, because this is the thing, you are so unique, because you are made up of all the things that you love and all the things that you hate, and the particular ways that you do like to do things and the particular ways you don't like to do things. And so actually, you know, if you put them all together, you are inherently going to make something unique to you and unique in the universe. So I'm just trying to connect all these dots, and so sort of making music, maybe playing the drums, but making electronic stuff, but then making real time or post-processed visualizations using things like Cinema 4D, and then I'm starting to tinker with Unity now as well, and just learn and see. And, you know, this stuff isn't commercial. This isn't, I'm not doing it to for an end. It is just a pure creative interest and intrigue and seeing where this stuff can go. And I kind of want to do all this stuff because why not, really? Again, why not? At the end of the day, there is nothing else. We're here, we are lucky enough to have the predisposition to be able to make something from nothing, making great stuff out of LEDs and programming and telling amazing stories. How the hell did you keep the timeline in your head of a futuristic AI scenario? I was amazed that you could keep that in your brain of fictional forward dates, but because that's your creative, you're interested and inspired and engaged, and it's sort of capitalizing on that and just going, well, the only other option I'm gonna do is just sit here and watch Game of Thrones. And that's great, but you will be there forever. You know, it's sort of, you've got to, I mean, you haven't got to, who am I? You're like, mate, I wanna sit at home. Fuck off. I just, you know, but you're here, you're listening, you've taken the time out of your day to come and hang out, and it's the free pizza, I get that, that's why I came. You know, but if we're already here and we're already engaged, then it's sort of using that time and using that energy that you already have to make stuff, because why not? And I believe about this stuff so much that it takes you in different ways sometimes, and I ended up writing a book on this whole thing, which was never a plan, especially my English teacher would definitely tell you this is never a plan. Ever that I would become an author, but it just happened. It happened through a convoluted process of doing talks, and that's something I never thought I would be confident enough to do. I'm quite shy normally, but for some reason over 10 years of doing this more and more, becoming more confident about it and enjoying it and sort of leaning into it really and going, okay, it is scary and it makes you feel sick because you're all looking at me and I don't know what I'm doing, you know. But just sort of seeing where those opportunities can take you. And for me, you know, writing a book was never, I would never imagine it in a million years. And I think the whole point is you just have to seek out this stuff wherever you can get it, because I have the greatest job in the world and I love it and I adore it. But at the same time, I am not 100% creatively satisfied all the time. And that's true of all of us, right? Because things are difficult. Commercial work in any form, whatever you're doing, can be stressful. It can be tiring, it can be difficult, it can be trying. So you're not always going to be 100% the whole time. And at the end of the day, it's up to us as individuals to go and seek that out. If you ain't getting it, got to find somewhere else to get it. And sometimes it takes a long time to sort of come round to that. It's kind of a hard choice because you're desperately searching for the answers. Then you think, well, actually, it's just up to me. No one, you know, my boss isn't going to give this to me. My co-workers aren't going to give this to me. My lecturer isn't going to give this to me. My teachers. And of course, they should give you encouragement and a network and a platform to be satisfied in your job, in your chosen career. But at the end of the day, the responsibility falls to us as an individuals. And I think as soon as I sort of cottoned onto this, I just felt like, okay, I'm in charge of my own time. So it made me want to make more stuff in my own time, made me want to put the work out there that I want to do more of, because that's a reflection of ourselves. You know, we're in the age of if everything is about your social profile, for better or for worse, but it is a reflection of who you are, what you're interested in, and people are going to see that and then go, well, I want to give the opportunity to that person. So, you know, it's sort of capitalising on that. And then if you take another step back, the sun's dying. So you better get off Instagram. You know, I try, you know, you get to a point and then you're so in your own head and you're worried about things and, oh, okay, my boss is a bit like this and all that. I keep wanting to make the damn logo bigger and I don't want to, and, you know, but then you take a step back and you go, okay, but that's just my work situation. You know, you always try and take a step back. I like to try and take a giant step back and just remember when things get a bit much that we are halfway through the life cycle of the sun and it's inevitable. Beautiful, beautiful death will engulf everything we've ever known and incinerate it and literally make it futile. So just get cracking. You know, anything. You know, when you just fall down the scroll thing and you're just like, yeah, get up in a minute, get up in a minute, get up in a minute. Then my brain goes, the sun's dying. Go, cool, okay. Anything. Use any trick that you can, because at the end of the day, it's all down to you. Like, no one else is going to make this happen for you. You have got to use any and all tricks to scare yourself. I love this technique. My wife hates it. She's like, stop talking about the death of the universe. She's like, I don't need you. I'm like, yeah, but don't forget, darling. She's like, oh my God, not everyone's as weird as you. Just stop it. I know that I need to get on. But I think the point is, it's finding something that works for you. And I kind of found a balance point for me where I try to be a realistic idealist or an idealistic realist. It's about picking the best parts of both of those things at any given time to make things happen. I think for me, I try and just be totally idealistic and just not worry that I don't have the skills or the resources or the money to make something happen, but and sort of use that energy to take me forwards to go, yeah, sure, I'm just gonna do it. But at the same time, you still have to be realistic and pragmatic as, okay, well, I know all of those things. I'm aware of all those shortcomings. How, realistically, am I gonna make that happen? Maybe it's changing it in scale to make it affordable, or changing it in time to make something shorter. Because for example, to use film as an example, I'm not gonna make a 2-hour feature film because that is completely unrealistic. But a 2-minute short that still is creatively satisfying me in the same way. It's still making something from nothing. It's still putting something out into the universe. It's achievable. It's realistic. But I'm still using the idealistic way to take me forward. So it's, again, just finding any tips and tricks to trick yourself, con yourself, whatever you need to do to go forward. And for me, it's all about sort of just trying to make things, as achievable. So I was not always the best use with my time. So I figured I'm a visual person. I'm a very simple person. I don't understand maths or anything like that. So Bristol JS is probably the worst place for me. I like, you know, everything split up. So my time, I just took a circle and divided it into 24 hours and just did it so I could get an easy realistic way of looking at where I was spending my time and where I wanted to spend my time. This is the thing, and it worked for me to just get a holistic view, that one step back, the perspective of what you want to do, how you want to spend those hours, those ticks and tocks, you know, really. And through mapping it out, it both showed me, A, that there are, and I don't know if you know this, there are 2 5 o'clocks in a day. So there's one, you know, tea time. There's also one early. Interesting. As soon as I heard that, I thought, why does no one else know about this? Apparently people do. Parents, they've heard of it. And people who do real work, they've also heard of it. But, you know, just sort of discovering these hours to try and fit stuff in, that's how I ended up writing my book, was in the wee hours because I couldn't do it in the evenings because my brain didn't work that way. And it was on suggestion of a friend that I try it. So just trying to do whatever you can to try and get the most out of your time, because it's hard. It's really, really, really hard. And I'll cover this in more detail, but it's incredibly difficult. But it's also worth saying, this is not about struggle porn. This is not a Gary Vaynerchuk, hey, just get up at 4 a.m. and then work for 97 hours in a week and then do this and blah, 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 blah. It's not about struggling, it's what works for you. What you might achieve in 3 minutes, it might take me, it probably would take me 3 days. You know, we're all different, we all work in different ways, in different capacities, and yeah, it's not about, you know, there's this weird LinkedIn culture, you've all seen this, right, of like weird tech bros who like, yeah, I get up at 4 a.m, I've drank 8 coffees, I kissed my family goodbye at 4:30, I've been in the gym 4 times, I've replied to 700 emails, it's 7 a.m, all right, mate, chill out. You know, it's this very bizarre place that we're in where it's all about sort of, yeah, the struggle, that you hustle harder than everyone else and no, we're all flipping unique, we're all different, you know. It's being kind to yourself and not comparing yourself to that. So that's what works for me. That is probably a stupid way for anyone else to work. And again, you know, I discovered getting up early was great for a short period of time and it got me to where I wanted to go. And then I sacked that right off. Because now my son, he's 2 and a half, he sleeps in a different time. So we can actually all stay until 7, which is a normal human time that I had heard of, not in this area. You know, so I now do my passion project time in the evenings, whereas when he was born, I swapped it around. And, you know, just again, it's your situation changes on a daily basis, on an hourly basis. So it's being flexible enough to change those things up. But this is me talking about me, and this is really about you guys. It's about everything that makes you you, the things that you love, the things that you're good at, the things that you're bad at, the things that you hate, the things that you know, the way that you look on life, but also your family, your weirdness, you know, all of these things make you you, and it is embracing that. And I'm slowly realizing to try, desperately try to not to compare, you know, yourself to others and really do it your own path. But I am fascinated though. There's this weird thing of, you know, and I'm sure in the coding and hacking community, you're all doing it in a weird, unique way, right? And you're like, oh, it's probably wrong. It's really wrong. And no one else is doing it like this. And people might laugh at you or you might be ridiculed or forum users are just being really mean because people on the internet are mean. If you follow someone famous or someone well-known and they're doing it in a weird way, but it's their style, they're revered for it, they're unique, what's this transition period? I don't get it, from being a weirdo and doing it wrong to, well, that's just how they do it. That's what makes them great. That's what makes them interesting. So I'm just trying to bypass that middle bit and just going, no, just maybe it's confidence. Maybe it's, no, this is how I do it. Yeah, it's not working. Shut up. It's how I do it. You know, you get there in your own time. You tweak it if it needs tweaking, but that might be your desired outcome. Yes, bro. No, it's not a bug. It's a feature. You know, that's it's up to you. And I think I'm fascinated by that gap. But maybe that gap is just self-imposed. And if we just go, no, this is how I'm doing things. I know it's wrong and broken, but it's my wrong and broken. That's the point, you know. And I love this. This is a great quote that if you don't tell your own story, then no one else will. And it's really simple. And we've probably seen this on Instagram as well. And you might scroll past it and go, wow. But it's so wonderfully true as well. This is Mira Nair, who gives a masterclass on masterclass.com. If you've not heard of it, definitely check it out. It's flipping brilliant. It's a place for masterclasses of all sorts of people who are making really interesting stuff. And they're very in-depth very in-depth lectures. They're just really interesting. But that really sort of stands out to me that, again, you might be telling the same story, but it's still your story. You are going to do it in your own way. And it is about that gap. because I kind of feel that all of this stuff, the interesting stuff that's going to happen to all of us in our careers, in our lives, that might make us start a family, it might make us make huge new decisions that, that branch way past work and what we create. They're all born from passions. It's the things that you care about. And I kind of just wanted to give you a tiny little potted history of where, for me, it's wonderful just to look back and sort of see these great places that you can go without even knowing. That's a wonderful thing. You don't plan any of this stuff. You know, you don't know what's going to happen to you after tonight. You might go and meet someone new tomorrow. You might see someone new on the train and that sparks a new relationship that takes you here or there. You know, the wonderful bit is not knowing. But it's really worth it, I think, to give yourself a bit of confidence to just take a minute and to look back, because you never know where it's going to take you. So for me, I would and still do make graphics and posters and things based on stuff I'm a fan of, and particularly rap music. I'm really into rap music and lyricism and wordplay, and generally because it always strikes up such bold imagery, I would just make posters on it for no reason, just because I wanted it to exist in the world, and again, add into my portfolio, wanted to get hired for the work that I wanted to do. We'll just make it. And through a funny series of events, a friend of a friend, I was introduced to one of my favorite rappers, who's a rapper called POS, who's an American rapper in a crew called Doomtree and a group called Treaders. And I've always loved their creative output. They're a real tight-knit crew from Minneapolis, Minnesota. Make interesting stuff. I'm just a fan. But, you know, just through making stuff and having a friend that I never knew would have the connections, I ended up meeting them and hanging out with them. Every time they come to Bristol, we hang out and we play. I took them to the Boston Tea Party. You know, that blew his mind, having a full English breakfast of a morning when he's still hung over from a big rap show the night previous. But, you know, that was just lovely, just to have that connection. But then it takes you in unexpected ways. So I ended up co-directing and designing and animating a title sequence for the Off Conference in Barcelona, which is a creative festival. It's bonkers, it's brilliant. I urge you to come. It's every year in Barcelona, in Spain. So it's beautiful and sunny. There's 3,000 people there. It's mental. It's totally Spanish. Nothing starts till midday. It's awesome. Everyone's very chilled. There's three big screens outside as well, so everyone has a beer in the sun and watches the talks, as well as three gigantic screens inside. It's a great thing. It's a very special thing to be part of. So I was really stoked to be asked to make something for them. It's a big deal. And so we made this very rap video inspired, mad, kinetic. We called it stop frame live action rap video motion graphics title sequence. It was a mixture of everything that we loved. But the rap video thing, we were always sort of aping it, really. We were mimicking the visual style. But we didn't have a rapper until I sort of realized, oh, I do know a rapper. I do know a rapper. I wonder how he feels about free work. Interesting. So I just sent him a message going, hey man, it's me, your weird Bristol friend. And just explained what I was doing and said, how would you feel about rapping the names of 52 people you've never met over one of your existing songs for free? And he went, yeah man, sure. I should ask rappers stuff more often. This is amazing. And so he made us this.
Anyway, stuff that rhymes well though. Yo, hey. All right, Joshua Davis, the godfather of Off, Kyle Cooper, Matt Lampert, and Mae Thug. Also got Andoni Bernstein, the man from Lamondo. Johnny Cupcake, shoes, the slang shirts from the Hunter. Mr. Bingo, Monica Mogi, Outro Studios, Echo's NPC, Us Two Sit.
You know, this blew my tiny mind. It was a wonderful, wonderful thing, and it fully completed the whole let's make a rap video, because we actually had a rapper doing a rap video. But when that finished, I was just so immensely grateful. It was a great event. We were really proud of that film. I said to him, Steph, the rapper, you know, dude, if I can ever repay the favour, then I'd love to make something for you. I'd love to make a real music video for you. And he said, yeah, man, sure, of course. And just thought he's been very polite. And then a year later, I just get a WhatsApp ping at 5 o'clock in the morning. He says, hey, man, new album's nearly finished. About ready for that video if you are. Okay, what? Yes, of course. Only problem, I've got something going on. When do you need it for? Oh, January. Okay, the thing is, my son's due to be born on February the 5th. Leave it with me. And that, to cut back to the time circle, is how I learned there's 2 5 a.m.s. That I would basically get up before my wife got up, and then my new son's sleeping pattern just had so... happened to fall that I could get up at 5 a.m, do a couple of hours work, and then he'd wake up again at 7. So it sort of worked, found this crazy time-space schedule to make things work. But it was a great, amazing way for me to sort of explore more of the stuff that I was interested in. And a lot of the work I do is very bright and colourful and happy, because that's the stuff I want to make. But I'm also interested in sort of the occult and graphics and symbolism. And because it was a passion project, because it was just a shared vision of, his only brief was, make it weird. Wicked. Just wanted to make something that explored more stuff that I wanted to do. And I've got this fascination with masks as well. And so just kind of wanted to make this weird thing that was totally open. And that opportunity wouldn't have happened unless, you know, we didn't create stuff that I was excited on in the first place, that would end up meeting him, that would end up asking a favour from him, that I would then need to repay the favour to him to make something. Yeah, I gotta scream it so loud that you can't look me in the face, or look the other way. It's confusing up the whole life. Anyway, I haven't got time for that. So I was then building up this body of work, of a sort of, I guess, a graphic style. It was motion graphic, it was graphic design and filmmaking and animated motion graphic typography and that sort of stuff. And so I got approached by a different creative festival called FITC that me and Adam have hung out at. It's also a great festival in Amsterdam. It just has really interesting stuff happening. But what's unique about them is they have 9 connected screens in this horseshoe shape that's a total resolution of 9,216 pixels by 768. It's this uber mental mega widescreen. So I just couldn't pass up the opportunity to make something, to try and push myself to learn. I didn't know if After Effects could handle that sort of resolution. Who knows? You know, you say yes and then you figure it out on the fly. And again, it was just another piece of work for the portfolio. This was at the time where I wasn't officially a director at Aardman, but I was getting more support with things. We got official support with the off titles a couple of years previous. So I wanted to bolster my reel. I wanted to do more work, and this was a great opportunity to have a great showreel piece. It was total free reign in a bonkers thing. I just said, can I make it neon pink? Because I love neon pink. I said, yeah, do what you want, mate. Fantastic. And again, just the opportunity to make something unique. Anyway, I haven't got time to watch that. So then it went on to something else. I was starting to build up this reel. And then when, fast forward a few years, I became a director for Aardman. I had this work on my reel that was high impact and hopefully had energy and was bright, and got approached by BBC Radio 4 to make a motion graphics, well, just a film celebrating the life of the incredible Maya Angelou. And so this was wonderful. I got this job because of the back catalogue of stuff I was excited and inspired by, and got to make this celebration of an incredible human being as part of my job. And I got here just by sharing the stuff I was passionate about. This blew my, and it still does blow my tiny mind. This was a couple of years ago now. And so it was just wonderful to sort of have such a great place for me to channel this energy. And it was never the plan. I never knew that this stuff would happen. And it's only by looking back that you think, God, this only happens because I made it public, the stuff I was excited and engaged with.
Maya Angelou, prolific, powerful, a polymath, with a life story that is uplifting, terrifying, as hopeful as it is harrowing.
Anyway, I haven't got time for that. You can see it on the internet. But, you know, it is about opportunity. It's about when things happen. And this quote just says it best. Opportunity does not knock. It presents itself when you beat down the door. There's like 7 billion people or something crazy on this planet. There's a lot of people. That's a lot of people banging on doors. So you've got to bang louder. You can't be, even though, this is the thing. I don't want to say that this is favouring the extrovert, because I'm here going, you know, being really loud and annoying. But it's also about, that's the way that I've got things done. But again, this is my personal story. It isn't, and it shouldn't be, how everyone operates. You know, maybe you are more introverted and you think, I don't want to stand in front of people like that knobhead. I just want to make things happen. You know, there are ways, of course there are ways to make those things happen. It's about identifying what works for you and to reach the people that you need to reach to make opportunities happen. It's about discovering that, but you won't know until you try. basically. Well, you know, what works for you, what doesn't work for you. And you kind of need to see other people and other things happen to go, that is not how I want to do it. You know, you, as much as it's about seeing people do what you want to do, it's also seeing people not doing what you, doing what you don't want to do in a way you definitely don't want to do it. You don't know until you, till you sort of, you know, sample the buffet cart and go, yep, 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 definitely not, you know. But anyway, I think this, you can break a lot of this stuff down, I think, to two things, time and energy. And we don't have much time, so I'm going to rock it through this. And what I love is this liberating feeling of, it doesn't matter who you are, it doesn't matter what class you are, what status you are, what sex you are, what race you are, what gender you are, anything, the, one of the very few things that combine us all is the hours in the day. That's it, we all have 24 hours in the day. And what I like to do is be like totally idealistic about this and just be positive and just think, well, I've got the same amount of time as Mozart. Me and him are the same, we've got the same constraints. Me and Beyonce have the same amount of time. Yes, A, people like Mozart are geniuses. That's a big thing, that's a really big thing, but there must be billions of geniuses in the world, but how do you know unless you put yourself out there? You might be a genius that just keeps everything to yourself and you never share, you never do, you never explore. You don't know. You don't know. That's genuinely true. You don't know. I know I'm not. I've explored enough to know I'm not. I have to just do this a lot and just go, ooh, me, please. You know, but that's what works for me. I've discovered that. But you might discover something inside yourself or someone else that you're like, you're really good. You're a genius. You know, you won't know until you push this stuff out. But then there's people like Beyonce that have assistance and money and lots of other things, but they're still all constrained by those same constraints. And yeah, again, you could be, you know, you could look at that and go, well, I'm the bloody same as Beyonce and I don't have that time. What's the point? Of course you can. That's your prerogative if you want to, you know, be on that side. But also you just go, okay, well, it's a positive then. I'll just use it. I'll use that information and go forwards. That's what I do. But it's also not about working more hours than anyone else. Again, to go back to that struggle porn thing, it's about not working harder, working smarter. It's about choosing where to spend your hours, choosing where to spend your minutes, you know, choosing when to be strict with yourself, to not be on Instagram, versus I just want to play PlayStation. I just want to watch Game of Thrones. Don't stop talking. You know, just it's up to you as a human being to decide where you want to spend that energy. Don't let anyone push you into a route or a way. It's, again, what works for you. And definitely don't let stuff stop you because you're not very good at it. You're never going to be good at it to begin. I am unique in that I started bad at drumming and I've got worse. That's a skill I'm very proud of. I don't quite know how it works, but it's true. You know, but you can't, man. We're all rubbish at everything that we start, and it's so hard to get over that pride, that embarrassment. I didn't start skateboarding until I was 19, and I sucked to begin with, and I got a bit better. But, you know, you go to a skate park, and there'd be a nine-year-old kid who'd do everything you've ever wanted to do in one try, and you'd be like, cool, yeah. No, it's all right. I'm a 20-year-old man now. Yeah, it's cool. No, it's fine. It's fine. That's weird. That's weird. And it's really, you can't style that out. You can't be like, yeah, I didn't want to try it anyway. You're at a skate park with a skateboard. And they're like, what are you doing, old man? You know, so there is things that are going to make you want to quit. But you've just got to try. You've just got to try and push past it. Again, that's about you getting inside your own head and going forward. And just doing it over and over and over and over and over. And over and over and over and over and over, because repetition develops intuition. You've got to. It's the only kind of way you're going to know about shortcuts to a way to do things more efficiently is to do it over and over again, because you'll start recognizing patterns. I'm, again, speaking, you know, preaching to the converted about understanding patterns, finding shortcuts, finding the best and most efficient ways to do things. But you're only going to do it, find it, by doing it over and over and doing it more. And then the other side of that is energy. It's all well and good having the time, right, I've got an hour, but you might have that hour and then think, not really feeling it. And that's even harder to contain, to coalesce, to make it work into something. But again, you've kind of got to work at it. It's not just going to come. And I sort of see it as a currency. You've got to decide where you're going to invest that, where you are going to spend it, really. You've got to sort of identify and just be a bit smart and proactive as to, okay, actually, I'm feeling really energetic. I'm feeling really proactive. Okay, I'm going to act on this right now because it might go. I understand my own patterns enough to go, yeah, it's really fleeting. And again, that's an individualistic thing because excuse me, changing is hard. It's really hard. Changing anything is really difficult. There's a reason being comfortable is comfy. You know, it's just, you ease into it and everything's great. This dude's turning into a car. Look how hot. Look, just like, oh, it's not easy. It's not nice. And you kind of, you've got to have the energy because you need the violence, really. You need the force to push past change, to change your mindset, change your routine, change the people around you. Because more often than not, what if you're trying to change something? It affects more than you. And if you're going to come up against these battles, you've got to have the energy to fight them, especially if it's in a workplace. So you're desperately trying to make something better. You deciding you want to change it can be relatively easy. Changing how it's implemented in a team or a task force or whatever it is, whether it's another person or 1,000 other people, it's going to be hard. So you've kind of got to have that energy to push against it because it's going to be really, really, really difficult. Anyway, luck is what happens when preparation meets opportunity. This is another great Instagram quote, but I don't care because it's beautiful. Because we all say we're lucky, of course, and I say it all the time, we're lucky, but actually, what luck is, it means you're prepared for the opportunity. You've done the work, you've done the research, you've done the hours, you've done the time, you've found the energy, you are ready for when that thing materializes into the ether, you grab it. And we call it luck, but it's a manufactured process. And it's quite nice to identify that because we can look at others and say, well, they're lucky. And they are, and there is luck. There is people that you're like, you don't deserve that. I'm really happy for you. Yeah, it's great. But you know, you do a better job. That happens, but that's life. But really, you know, normal luck for us mere mortals is actually about being prepared for, and it is just doing the stuff, trying, iterating, making things happen. And it's finding people who will support you on that journey, who have been there before you, that will share their wisdoms. I mean, he doesn't look too thrilled. It's just like, yeah, I'm your mentor, oh, God. But also it's repaying that to other people as well. It's if you recognise someone that is also going through the same things as you and you know the shortcuts, don't hold on to that knowledge. Again, someone's dying, what do you care? You know, share it, pass it on, give them the cheat codes, do it. Why would you not? You know, I get it, it's a very naturalistic process. And of course, we're all guilty of it, that you just cling on to this thing, this knowledge, whatever, because it's taken you a damn long time to accrue that. But again, take a step backwards. It's kinder and nicer to help, to elevate, to give people platforms. And that's more important now than ever, as finally we are in a place where we're talking about inequalities in race, gender, everything. We're finally talking about how massively unfair everything is. You know, we need those times where people are lifting people up, allies. I love that word, being an ally in any form that you can, whether that's two people who are different races, gender, sexes, or friends in an industry. It can apply to everything. So I think it's just nice to just try and lift people up where you can. Be fluid and flexible about this stuff as well. You know, just because you made a decision on that 10 years ago that you're like, yeah, that's my viewpoint, it might not be the same. I kind of wish more people were fluid and flexible. I find it insane that we change our phones every damn year, yet we cling to this sort of like, well, that's what I decided when I was 18. You don't know anything when you're that. You don't know anything when you're any age. Why are we putting a number on it? Why are we so obsessed with, well, that's that? You know, I kind of feel like the flipping country would be a bit better off if it was a bit more fluid and flexible when they got new information, because they were lied to 3 years ago. But anyway, you know, it's about being, I'm not bitter, it's about being, you know, fluid and just embracing that and trying to be malleable in any situation, because I just think it's you can cling to stuff and you can have a stake in the ground and this is what I believe. Of course, it's not a weakness. If anything, I think it's a strength to say, no, I thought that, now I think something different, and here's why. Because I've been through it, I've iterated, I've seen this, I've done this, I know that. You know, that's a real strength. And again, more than ever, it's really important to be kind. Not like this prick. You know, just, and I know it's the simplest thing to say, of course, it's of course be kind. We all know it, we're kind, but again, there's just even more of a scrutiny, rightly so, that we need to think about how our actions impact other people. Again, of course, I'm talking about in our creative careers of us making and doing stuff. But because we're so lucky to operate in this world where we can just put something into the universe, you know, it's also thinking about its implications and can we do something even better that helps with the people that's kind, you know? Again, it's a really obvious statement, but it, I think, should always be repeated forever, for all time, until the sun is dead, because we need to be, not like this prick. But we need to work just as hard as, you know, it's so easy to get input all the time for all this different stuff. Well, we need to work just as hard to just decide what noise just to filter out. There's so much stuff happening, chatter all the time, that we need to put as much effort and energy into deciding what to block out. And I know right now it just feels like information overload in every single way. So again, it's something that we need to work hard at to filter out, and that then comes back to energy, that comes down to sort of find, you know, it's like management. It's basically, we're talking about managing your time and your own brain space all, every single second of the day to be your best possible version of yourself. It's really exhausting, but you know, it pays dividends, I think, because you feel happy and you feel creatively satisfied. And it's about just, things are gonna go wrong, you're gonna fail, you're gonna screw up, and I think you just have to take it on the chin and carry on. And you know, when you do screw up, remember at school and you do something wrong and you get called into the headmaster's office and you just have that horrible feeling of dread in your heart and your throat and you're like, oh God, this is the worst, my parents are gonna kill me. And you desperately try and push that feeling away. I think when something does go wrong, you actually need to hold on to it a bit and embrace it and sort of learn from it again, just sort of take it, iterate it and change it. I use skateboarding as an example, something that I love, but I am terrible at, because I find it insane. This is a professional, he's a professional, there you go, he landed it. This is an infamous set of steps. They're absolutely massive. They look quite small in comparison here. They are absolutely lethal. We call the Wallenberg Four. And you know, the fact that he's a professional, his whole career is fail, 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 break my arm, fail, 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 break my ankle, fail, 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 fail. Oh, I landed it. I'm gonna do something else now. Fail, fail. But you know, that's insane. That's so insane. Why would you do that to yourself? But that's really important. But what I love about that, and I'm hoping my boy, if he's interested, wants to take up skateboarding, because what that sort of teaches you about failure, about hurting, you realize that, you know, you just need to sort of take those knocks in whatever form and just get up and just carry on, really. I think it's a really important lesson to learn. But at the same time, you can't just push it away. It is about sort of embracing that feeling of, oh God, I don't like this, and sort of taking one part of it. Don't hold on to it so much that you just become jaded and you become miserable and you think, well, what's the point? I always fail. And again, that's why you need to work at it, because it's not natural. It's going to feel horrible and you're like, I'm failing sucks. Why is he talking about it? It hurts. But it's sort of, again, trying to separate the two and realise that, okay, I'm going to hold on to this bit because this is going to help me grow, but push that other stuff away and not let it jade you, not let it change your mindset. Because this is it. I write this as a creative career, but this is anyone's career. This is it. This is it. We will do this forever. We will come to work, we will go to school, we will do... There's nothing else, really. Again, you take that step back, and I think as soon as we all accept that, well, this is it, so I'm just going to do the best I can, I'm going to make the best stuff I can, I'm going to be the kindest person I can, that it ain't going to get better than infinitely zooming into Shrek's mouth. This is it. This is what we've chosen. This ain't real work, is it? Let's be real. We're not, you know, putting a roof on in 40 mile an hour gusts. We're not doing open heart surgery. We're not driving an ambulance to put, you know, this is easy. I'm really stressed. It's this, isn't it? Moving the mouse a bit. You know, just, again, I know that's incredibly simplistic and possibly offensive to lots of you, but it's also offensive to me, because, again, you've got to get real. We ain't doing real work. So if we're so damn lucky to have those opportunities, you've got to do the best that you can with it and just be like, I'm going to be the best, you know, because at the end of the day, it's about being positive and it's about amplifying other positive messages, other positive people, and just shouting and being an ally to the other people doing great things out there and giving them a platform, giving them a boost, because why the hell would you not want to? I wished every time we logged onto the internet, this statement would appear. Praise in public, criticise in private. I really do. I just wish every time anyone logged on, it'd go, just remember, don't be a dick. Okay, cool, thanks, internet. You know, I kind of wish this was more prevalent, really. It's such a simplistic statement to say, but of course, actually, we just need It's that negativity, hard work, man. We're all exhausted, right? I'm not just speaking for myself. We've had all of these conversations today. We're all exhausted all of the time of being outraged because lots of things suck. So actually, it's trying to just if we can do anything to get those negative messages out there, then we're all going to feel great. And just stop thinking about it. Just get on with it. Just stop thinking so much and just stop playing, start getting it wrong, start screwing it up, start making mistakes, start getting frustrated. You know, at least if you're getting frustrated, it shows that you're engaged, you're doing it. Sure, you want to smash up the thing and you want to rip it out and do all that, but you're feeling something. You are actively engaged, and that's a good thing because you are just on your process. Because, possibly controversial statement, but I do believe a bad something is better than a brilliant nothing. You know, at least a bad something in the world we can iterate on. We can make it better, we can add on to it, or we can scrap it and start again. We've all had those, you know, we've seen stuff in whatever guise and we've gone, yeah, I could have done that. Yeah, but you didn't. It doesn't matter how simplistic it is. It doesn't matter, well, that's easy, I could have done that. Yeah, but if you didn't, shut up, make it, go. Stop, even have it, don't even say it, don't even let the words come out of your mouth, just go and then stroll off. And start making the better thing, you know. Again, we're all guilty of doing this, and that's, again, being realistic. It's fun. It's fun to bitch. It's really fun to bitch. That's also why the internet's great. That's what it was invented for. You know, but again, it's sort of being realistic that I'll have a little whine for 10 minutes, and then the other 50 minutes of the hour, I'm going to be proactive, and I'm going to make this thing better, you know. So it's about that push and pull the whole time. Because at the end of the day, you are your biggest barrier. You are in your own stupid head all the time, worrying. Is it good enough? Am I good enough? That's not good. This is bad. Who am I? What? I'm confused. I'm scared. All the time. And this will be it forever. You can't escape your own brain unless we get into AI sentience, and then you've got a whole other set of things to worry about. But right now, it is you in your own brain. But also, you are your biggest catalyst as well. You can just think, oh, it's okay to be confident. It's okay to do something and feel proud and go, I made that. You know, there's a way to be confident in what you do and not be arrogant, for sure. I think it's all about how you communicate things. And it's just taking pride. It's that beautiful, lovely feeling of making something from nothing that we all do and just feeling stoked. And it's great that Adam puts on events like this to share other people doing those things and excited because you're all in this room because you are doing the same things. But it's about, you know, just being kind to yourself at the end of the day, being kind to yourself to let yourself be a catalyst and push you forward. Anyway, the world's terrible. You're awesome. Bye, Bristol.
Bang.